Hello, fellow Hearthstonians. My name's Rob.
And I'm Eve.
And I'm Andrew.
And we're the hosts of Velen's Chosen Podcast,
where we discuss budget options for Hearthstone players
and strategies for constructed ladder play.
And you're listening to
Coin Concede.
I guess that'll work, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Well, hello everyone, and welcome to episode 19 of Coin Concede, a Hearthstone podcast. My name is Kenny, and I have my legendary co-host, Kevin. How are you doing?
Hey. I'm doing great.
Good. And our co-host, legendary co-host, Rob.
What up?
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Why don't I get one of those?
Well, you're here every
that's
week.
Not fair.
Because you show there. Up on schedule.
All right, so let's first start with getting to know Rob. So, Rob, let's get to know you. Tell us a little bit about maybe how you got into gaming and with where you are today and what you're involved with.
Well, if you've ever listened to my show, you know I'm very long-winded, so I'll keep this short.
I am too, don't worry.
Yeah. All right, so gaming, wow. My first gaming system was a Super Nintendo, and my first video game I've ever played, man, what was it? I think it was actually like the original Mortal Kombat. I mean, it wasn't on the game system. It was like at a legit 90s arcade. So, yeah, it was pretty sweet. But anyways, I had like only four games growing up. It was like a Super Mario collection. I had like four Mario games in it. And then I had Ninja Turtles game because that was like my childhood. It was kind of like Tekken for Ninja Turtles, basically. So I had those things. And I grew up going up from that. I was a Nintendo guy. So N64, GameCube, Super Smash Bros. Guy. Love the Smash, man. That's good stuff.
Got to play in that then, a little bit in college, but yeah. Go ahead.
Wait, say that again. I'm sorry.
No, I was gonna mention I played Nintendo. Like that was the only game console I had was the original like the OG Nintendo, and then I got into Smash in college and playing with my friends. But yeah, sorry to interrupt. Great. Keep going. We're still getting to know you.
So right around the time after I had gotten my million hours into Donkey Kong 64, I rolled my sleeves up and found the Pokemon trading card game. So I played that for a little bit, and I thought that was fun. And I was so young, though, so I didn't really understand like basic concepts of like card advantage. And my friend was just like this ultra super nerd. Like the guy could be an engineer if he wanted to, but he's so smart. He had like, I remember he had this deck. Like, Pokemon decks are 60 cards, right? His deck was literally three copies of a Mewtwo and all energy cards. And all he would do every turn was try to, like, he had basically a 1 in 30 chance to draw a Mewtwo on his opening hand, Mulligan. And he got it, and we played, and we literally had a game last for, like, almost an hour, because all he would do was use the barrier ability and wait until I decked myself and I lost. I was like, that is the most broken deck. Oh, my word. So it was pretty intense. And that was my first introduction to basically like competitive card games. And then I moved into playing Yu-Gi-Oh! So I really relate with the television show backdrops that Kevin and Cora brought to your guys' show, listening in every week.
Mm-hmm.
So I love Yu-Gi-Oh! I played a deck that's kind of like an aggressive mid-range deck. Like Yu-Gi-Oh! Has its own style, so I can't really say it's like a face hunter deck, but it's what they call the beatdown version. It was like, okay. It was so fast. Lots of 1800 attack creatures, only flip effect cards, so like for removal and spells and trap cards that removed your opponent's minions. And then it ran like three endgame cards, and it was a very tight list. And then I always had three cards that were like in my deck that were just super surprise factors. I was known for being the beatdown guy with a Barrel Dragon in his deck because Barrel Dragon was ridiculous. Do you remember, Kevin, this is a card that was two sac creatures and you could flip three coins, and if two of them were heads, you could destroy anything you wanted. It was legit. And so what I would do is I'd lock them down with Jinzo and drop two creatures, and then I'd play Barrel Dragon and Jinzo, and it just locks them out. It was so cool. It was the dopest deck. And the best part was I was like 11. I was beating these kids that were coming in.
this kid knows.
It's just like, oh, snap, the kid with braces and glasses. Grab your purses. Don't let him steal.
So how did that get you into Hearthstone?
So Hearthstone was really funny. One of my friends got me into like a bunch of games, and I met him through camp, and it was right as I was heading into grad school, and we worked together, and he's like, hey, check out this game. It's in beta right now. I was like, okay. It looks a lot like Yu-Gi-Oh! And the competitive trading card game that WoW just made. I bought a few cards, and I was like, man, this looks so good, but they just discontinued it. And he's like, well, let's go buy a raid set and just play around with it on the weekends. I was like, okay. Sounds like a nice unwind thing. Just play raid bosses because I don't want to spend the time in WoW anymore. I played WoW for 5 years, by the way. Like on nice. And off. Yeah, Heavy Raider and Lich King.
Pretty much me too.
Yeah, so Hearthstone has been like one of the best games. It's been super nice for me. It's like super easy just to sit down and play a few games, stay competitive, have a great podcast with some fun people, and have a really neat community around it that's really casual. And it's easy to watch. It's really fun to watch. And it's kind of like sitting down in the Super Bowl almost anytime you want to watch it, because you can just grab snacks and just chill and enjoy the strategy behind it.
I love that part of it. That's pretty much the majority of when I get a chance to watch it, is when I'm doing stuff with my baby or, you know, feeding him or whatever. And then just sides, you know, I'll be watching a show with my wife and then I'll be playing Hearthstone. It's something where you can kind of multitask to do. Sorry about the noise. He's kind of really into his shakers now.
He's smorking.
Yes.
Speaking of Yu-Gi-Oh! Real quick, I always thought it would be cool if Hearthstone like made some kind of like field spell card where you could like make it so the
field... Like change the field?
Yeah, like a field spell.
Dude, field cards were the coolest. Like Toon World was like the most revolutionary thing that Yu-Gi-Oh! Ever did. It's just like...
Yeah.
And they could never translate it out of the television show like properly, because I made a Toon deck when I finally had enough money and I wasn't 12. I was like, oh, this Toon deck is actually really bad, and I just spent a bunch of money to make it.
Rip. No, yeah. Rip or cartoon. Or like some kind of card that, remember how you could like change a monster into like whatever type you wanted?
See, polymorphization was something that like made me quit the game, because it was just everything was polymorphable, and I was like, it's cool, but like they took it two steps too far, and like...
Yeah.
Just
like something with an effect, like you can change a minion to be like a beast or something, and like you take like a
persisting effect
Yeti.
Or like a permanent modifier.
A permanent modifier for like.
So it's like a silenceable effect.
Yeah. Or
okay. Because like there's the modifiers, right? Like
I got what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess either. I just think it would be kind of cool. Like, you could make some of those like beast synergies work. Like, change your.
Yeah, I think it would be treasure. Awesome if they made like a spell that like for instance, like Tree of Life. If instead Tree of Life was like change the field so that it heals all minions for one health at the end of every turn. And I was like, that'd be cool. It's just like super gimmicky, but it'd be fun.
And there could be like a really cool animation where like
the field changes. Like the whole board just changes from sand.
Like, it changes into, like, a forest. That'd be so cool.
We should be game designers, Kevin.
Yeah, we should.
We should get paid for this.
Yeah.
I'm not giving out any more free ideas.
Let's just go to Hearthstone and be like, hire us.
Yeah, there you go.
We got the ideas.
All right, cool.
All right, so, Kevin, what we got for the show? It's enough about me.
Well, first, let me mention, since we have Rob on here, he's from Velen's Chosen, so they kind of focus on like a free-to-play / budget decks and how you can kind of get around with what you're playing. So if during the show, if you come up with any questions, just put up in chat, in the Twitch chat, and we'll be sure to add those for later in the show. That way we can ask him some of those questions. And then also next week, we're going to be having a joint episode with the Death Rattle crew. So we'll go ahead and announce more when we find out more and get it solidified. But we're definitely going to have it next week. Yeah, it's going to be fun.
This is awesome.
Yeah. All right. So actually, Kevin, you want to head into the news?
Yeah, sure.
Let's do it.
Do you have like the bumper?
All right, so in the news this week, we have Winter Veil comes to Hearthstone. So those of you who've played WoW,
hooray!
You'll definitely know it. We have our personal...
Thank you.
It's our solo, yay.
Feast of Winter Veil.
But so what's cool about it is they're actually going to add different maps for the Stormwind map and the Orgrimmar map. I think it's cool that it's just those two, but I was hoping it would be all of them. But it's still better than nothing. So something unexpected.
Rudolph Griffin's pretty cool.
I haven't had a chance to check him out. It came live today, right?
Yeah, it's so live today through the 6th of January.
Wednesday. So we're recording on Wednesday night. But
I had no idea that was happening, and I just went on Hearthstone today and. And then whatever hero I was playing against, they're like, "Happy Winter Veil," and I was just like, "What?" Because I've never
answered like so what?
I had no idea what that meant. I was like, "What? What did I walk into?"
Well, and that was the other thing.
Yeah, right.
That was the other thing too.
Is this somebody else's Christmas party?
When you first log in, it does say, you know, the Winter Veil savings up until, you know, the dates, and it says you can buy 40 classic packs and get an extra 10 classic packs free.
Probably made it weird for me is that it didn't do that for me.
What?
Until I just logged on. It didn't do that for me either.
Really?
So, yeah, I had no idea.
Hmm.
Yeah, I wonder if I re-log if it would do that, but probably not.
Maybe, I don't know. I mean, I re-logged, 20 minutes ago.
They changed it so it just reads instead of like 40 packs for $50 or 70 packs for or 60 packs for $70, it just reads 50 and 70.
Gotcha.
But if you like switch to, you know, like Grand Tournament or GBG, it just goes back to the original pricing.
Hmm.
Oh, okay. Oh, and the classic packs are that thing is live, like you can do that whenever.
Mm-hmm. Through the 6th.
Oh, nice. So get your packs.
This is definitely something for budget players, not just free to play. But we have our taglines for like budget and free to play. So like if you got a budget, this is the way to go because you can spend $40 on Amazon coins right now.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. How's it good work with the Amazon coins on top of that? It's probably even better.
Amazon coins is like it basically gives you a 10% discount all the time, and then sometimes when you spend $50, they give you a 20% off. So, like, if you spend $50 or $100, it'll actually be you spend $80 and you get $50 worth of currency. I'm sorry. You spend $40, $50 worth of currency, or you spend $80, you get $100 worth of currency.
So, with the Amazon coins, you'll get close to 30% savings, basically.
Yeah.
Not quite, but almost.
Pretty close.
Cool.
Back when I used to buy packs, that was the one thing I regretted was not doing it through like Amazon coins and stuff, because I could have gotten a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I needed any.
It's tough because you have to have some sort of Android device in order for it to work.
Yeah, that was the problem. I didn't have any kind of Android device or anything.
So rip me.
Yeah, and like back when I was on a team, I used to like get a lot of money to put into packs too. So like I could have had a lot more. I mean, I have plenty, but...
Sure.
Yeah. Good trick. If you guys have an Android device, be sure to do that.
Yep, install Amazon Underground, and then use that to install Hearthstone, and then link it, like, by buying your... You can buy coins, and then use the coins in the game. That's how it works.
Cool. And, Rob, you want to...
just get an emulator and do it.
Yeah, I'm too lazy to. I wouldn't even... I'm just...
I, like, tried to, and then I just kind of, like, gave up.
Yeah,
I was too lazy to finish.
That's how you get the Samsung back.
Yeah.
So, Rob, you want to cover? There was like an issue with
Oh, Yeah, okay. So yesterday I get in the game and I hit play on my Battle.net client and it says, sorry, there's an error. We can't launch the game. I was like, wait, what? And then like starts like launching a patch. And I was like, okay. So maybe it's like patching the game. And then it like stops midway through and says, we can't do something. Check this site. And like I punched in the code and like went into Blizzard. I have no clue. Basically what happens is if you have a VAST on a PC, it like flags like 12 elements of the most recent patch and it doesn't let you in. So
really?
there's a workaround on Reddit. So just go to like Hearthstone subreddit and then like limit your search and just search like a VAST error or whatever. Basically you have to open up the program and then like set these things to like release them out of like the quarantine zone and like make an exception for those things so it doesn't quarantine them anymore. And then you have to like repair your client and then like close it and relaunch it and you're good.
That sounds like so much fun.
It was stupid because I actually had Alec from Golden Wisp was going to give me some Freeze Mage lessons last night and I only got like 2 games in because he had a late interview with Admirable and then didn't get in late, and then I had to play a bunch of games on mobile, and then, like, Skype in on my computer. It was really stupid.
That sucks.
Even up misplayed by, like, grabbing an ice barrier instead of, like, a Frost Nova and somehow won the game. I was like, oh, gosh.
Hey, whatever that works.
Yeah.
Wasn't a misplay, because you won.
That's what the pros say.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, so...
Not a misplay, it's just, yeah.
There you go.
Sorry, yeah, okay, go ahead.
Oh, no worries. I know that we have a lot to cover, so
yeah.
I don't want to skip over the news. If you guys want to, was there anything else you wanted to mention? Either
we talked about
I think
we
talked
about the greeting emotes.
Yeah, you mentioned that because you went in and you started.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's it.
All right, cool.
I think that's it. Oh, besides like the boards, like if you actually look closely on your boards, portion. Two maps has like this little slight snow that's coming down, and that's like the coolest part of the board.
I'll have to check it out.
It's really neat.
All right, cool.
It's like an extra element.
So let's go ahead and go into our League of Explorers section. Cue music. One of these days I will get that voice. I keep mentioning it. I keep forgetting, though. I should write myself a note. All right, so let's
put a warlock at the end.
So let's go ahead and talk about our adventure experiences from last week because our recording is the night before it comes out. So we'll start with our guest Rob. What did you think of the encounters? You can go individually or just overall. It's up to you.
Okay. Giant Finn can go sit in that cauldron that he put Murlocs in beforehand because he's a douche canoe. I don't like him.
A douche canoe.
And by the way, Rob always has the best sayings and substitutions for words. I swear.
That was clever. I like that.
I cannot. Well, I'm a big fan of Owen Rogers' work on YouTube. That's where I get a lot of it. So
he also says, "Oh my word."
Yeah. So Giant Finn is the most retarded boss. And Slither Spear was I really liked how they designed that fight for the normal mode a lot. I thought that was just brilliant. And then Nazjar was like probably the coolest animation for any boss to date. Like that wave thing hitting the board every turn was incredible.
Yeah.
And it was hilarious when I spammed the board with a bunch of tokens. And then they upgraded, and I got a Doomsayer, and it goes, and I was like, wait, what happened?
Yeah.
And I had to go, like, go into the corner and see the refreshment. I was like, oh, snap, I got a lot of good cards. Stink. Stupid Doomsayer.
That sucks.
It was hilarious. I ended up winning, but it was just so funny.
You'll have to remind me, the last time I played this was the day it came out last Thursday, so almost a week ago. What was Lord Slither Spear's thing?
It was like... He enrages, or he summons a hungry Naga every turn, and then on normal mode, if you kill the cauldron that Murgleton's in, you get Murgleton in your hand, and then he goes to enrage, where it just gives him 2 attack every turn, and he just smorks you.
we saved Finley.
Yeah. And then it's funny because, like, I thought the boss was broken in heroic mode. I was like, wait, all of the little data said that Murgleton's in a cauldron and it's 0-10 and I'll get Murgleton. And then his hero power changed so that he does 5 damage instead of 2. And I'm facing down these hungry Naga that are like 11-11s and I'm getting smashed. I was like, this isn't real life.
Yeah.
And that's like exactly how you have to fight the boss. And Yang Wu tweeted back at me. He's like, no, sometimes we add the assets to the game to trick people, basically. It's like, we don't always put them on the fight, and good luck. And I was like, you suck!
Son of a bitch.
I had the hardest trouble with this wing.
Oh, God.
I think this wing was the most... it was the hardest for us to go through. Now, I do both heroic and the normal. Normal wasn't so bad, but heroic, I just kind of beat my head across some of them. Yeah, Rob and I were talking back and forth that day.
40 times.
Yeah, I didn't have to do it that much. Maybe closer to 10, but still.
Was it really that hard?
It was much harder.
Not necessarily. It wasn't that hard, per se. It was hard if you're trying to, like, put your listeners first and not use your whole collection. I ended up using like a lot more epics on this run than I did the previous one, like Hunger Crabs and Doomsayers and one legendary. Like I put in a Black Knight.
The first day after that came out, I put 2 Hungry Crabs in all my decks, and then like almost never got to use any of them. I was so sad.
Yeah, the OTK is kind of like with Paladin is just so much so that like if you kill them, it's not that big of a deal. And then when they bring them back alive with anything, you're dead. So,
yeah, we had some fun with that, huh?
What did you think of the encounters, Kevin?
Oh, well, I haven't played any of the heroics. I like to do them all at one time. Okay. So, yeah, I just played them on normal. And, yeah, it was fun. I liked saving Finley. It was, I got really mad at Slither Spear for trying to cook him. And then I was so happy when he, like, just came into my hand, and I was like, yes! Like, let's go.
I want to see the face of somebody that, like, silenced the cauldron, and was just like, I'm not letting him out. That would be funny.
You can silence it. Just like on the other wing. The wing that had the totem.
Yeah.
Does Slither Spear like keep his regular hero power the whole time then?
Yeah, he just he increases the health and the attack, I think.
So in heroic mode.
In heroic
mode. But only attack in regular.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you can just play priest and a wild pyromancer just rips his board, so.
Yeah, right. Easy.
Yeah, there's different things. It's still doable. It took me longer to kind of figure it out, but it's worth doing. It's fun.
It's tough.
Yeah. All right, so that's pretty much our experience. You guys want to start talking about the cards for tomorrow, I should say? I was going to say next week.
Sure. Oh, by the way, the class challenges for this wing was awesome. They're really
fun.
For
the past wing?
Yeah.
Which ones were they?
That's how you got any Finn this week. You actually had to play against Finn with a Murloc Pally deck, and it was awesome.
It was the three of them. It was the Hunter, Shaman, and Priest. You should have known the priest.
Because the priest one, you got to use in Tomb on Nazjar's stuff, I think.
Okay.
And the Hunter was the Smorkdown Slither Spear deck, I think. I could have gotten it wrong, but I think that's right.
Okay.
Cool. Since it's hard for me to kind of pull up everything, and we're doing the live shows, I'm going to have Rob actually go over a lot of the new cards. We'll start with we'll go each encounter. So it's going to be slight spoilers.
Semi-spoilers.
We're just mainly focusing on the cards, and we'll go over the encounters next week.
Yep. Okay, so boss one is Skeletorus Rex, or Skelosaurus. He gives... Oh, by the way, this wing has 4 bosses. You're welcome. That's the main spoiler, so beware.
More fun.
There's something after boss 3. I don't know if they're actually hiding it. You know how they have the little coins? I don't know if they're hiding the 4th boss. Because that would be pretty dope, but...
I think that's one thing that I love, like opening up the wing and you have the plane go across and then you hear like the stone sliding.
It sounds like a tomb opening or yes. crypt or something. It's
I
so cool.
love that. It's so awesome.
It's the best.
Yeah. All right.
Okay, so a Skelosaurus will give us a druid card, which is a 1-mana spell called the Raven Idol. This actually says discover a minion or discover a spell. And the second card you get is a minion, a neutral minion, Fossilized Devilsaur for 8 mana, and it's an 8/8 body with a battle cry. If you control a beast, this minion gains taunt. So it turns into an Ironbark Protector.
Nice.
You might get an Ironbark Protector. You might get a card that no one wants to play.
Also, it's important to note that this card is actually not a beast.
Yeah.
True. So, if you're running a beast deck, this is a synergistic card that does not hold the archetype you're looking for.
Well, it's fossilized.
Is Devilsaur a common?
It is a common. So, it's an extremely good, valuable arena card.
I thought he was seriously asking, like in real life. Is a fossilized Devilsaur a common thing?
It lives in the wild.
Depends on how many times you've seen Night of the Museum.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, yeah.
So, Kevin, what do you think of these? Do you foresee this in any decks? Do you think these are going to be common, not common?
Like, Raven Idol kind of intrigues me.
It's very intriguing.
Because
the golden art for this is amazing.
Is it really?
Oh, it's so cool.
I haven't looked at it. Oh, well, I guess I'm going to have to look at that now. But, yeah. I mean, it just seems like a nice, solid card. Like, you get the choice.
It's 1 mana. It's a lot of value.
Yeah, it's 1 mana. You can pick whichever you want. I mean, I don't see that not being played. Like, honestly,
right.
it's just solid.
It's also good to kind of fill out your curve too. If you have something that's
curve
better.
Curve is so awkward with Druid.
Because sometimes you want to innervate, and then you innervate one extra to get out that big minion, and it's, well, okay, what am I going to do with that one extra?
Oh my gosh, you can full combo on turn one.
Whoa.
Raven Idol, coin Raven Idol, and the, like, double innervates, and you have, like, 2 in your hand already. 4 innervate turn. Hype? That'd be insane.
Wow, Trolden. Where's Trolden?
There you go. Or better yet, you can run double Raven Idols in your Astral Communion decks. More hype.
Wow. I'm by the way, I'm looking at the art right now, and it looks really cool. I agree. That's awesome.
It reminds me of what's it called? The Ark of Anubis from Yu-Gi-Oh! It's a trap card.
Oh, yeah.
That was like one of my favorite cards arts in all of Yu-Gi-Oh! It was very cool. I think I still have it in my drawer.
That's the thing I really liked about Yu-Gi-Oh! Is it had some, like, really cool art and stuff.
Yeah. So, Kenny, what do you think about Raven Idol, man?
I'm excited. I kind of want to play around a little bit with it, just to see, you know. It's commons for the druid, and then also common neutrals. So, I don't know. It'd be interesting. It reminds me of... I don't know. I think it's going to be so cool, though. I mean, you have so much to choose from, either spells or minions. And just the... what's the word I'm looking for? How well it can be...
Versatility?
Yeah, the versatility and the skill it increases.
Yeah.
I mean, so, that's one thing I like about the druid, is being able to choose between different things.
It's like a flexible class, basically. It's kind of like the druid theme.
Yeah.
Right.
And ramping.
So... Yeah. Give them a skateboard because they're going up some ramps. okay, so the Raven Idol for budget players. Like, I know this sounds really weird, but, like, if budget players are not necessarily concerned with buying packs and, like, are really pursuing after getting adventures and, like, Cora's doing, just spending your gold each week. I think the Raven Idol is actually one of the biggest key cards for people looking to play Druid on a budget. Because you're able to just, like, fill in the gaps with literally whatever you're missing. And I don't think this card will be used much, if any, with the minion discovery. Like, that is such a massive pool. And then you have, like, a 4x ratio on getting a druid minion. And frankly, I think the druid minions are about 50-50 that you're going to get something you need, like a keeper or a druid of the fang or a druid of the claw, right? Or an ironbark protector, or God knows you get a Cenarius. Holy cow, that'd be crazy. But like, I think it could be used for that if you're like spell heavy hand, or if you don't have any spells. Like, I know that budget players don't necessarily have all of the minions, so you maybe compensate for that by having extra removal for one mana. So and again, budget players that are really into Arena are really gonna like this card. This can literally swing the entire Arena game. Like, that's why I love this card. It's so cool. Like, throw this in your Arena deck. It's a common. If you see it, it's kind of like, how do you evaluate this card? Like, I would love to just go and dig up some tier scores on this card. Like, because I think it's right around a 45% chance you're gonna get a useful spell. And it's like a 25% chance you get like a god tier spell, like Swipe. You know what I mean? Yeah, like, if you just sit down and look at your collection and just like click Druid and type in spell.
Easy.
There's so many cards.
I have a question for you about like budget and free to play players.
Fire away.
Do you find that certain classes are significantly better than others?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So there's actually a big reason why Mage is the first class that you're introduced to, right?
Right.
Can you, like, run me through why you think a Mage is a good class to start with?
Because it's got a lot of basic... let me just bring up the basic set. It's got a lot of great basic cards, like Fireball, Flamestrike. Yeah.
It's versatile, too.
It has so many useful basic cards.
And answers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That are... Like, I think the best way to think about classic cards is, or not classic cards, sorry, basic cards, is if they are timeless cards that have shown up in every expansion as cards that are being played, you should be paying attention to that class as a budget player.
Yeah, that's totally true.
Like Arcane Missiles, every tempo deck.
Yeah, right. And so my follow-up is, what do you think about, like, Ramp Druid is like a budget or free to play class? Because I remember when I used to play on accounts with no cards, I like to play Ramp Druids, because you just got like the wild growths and innervates, and then you could just curve into whatever big creatures you have, and then like you automatically get swipe.
Yeah, because Ironbark Protectors are actually pretty good. Like, if you don't have anything in your collection, an 8/8 with Taunt is nasty. Right. I will say this, like, the aggro druid archetype was surprisingly really effective for my cousin-in-law. Shout out to my friend Spencer, who I went over to Thanksgiving for my in-laws, and then we went to my in-laws, let's see, so this would be my mother-in-law's family, and their son Spencer, just got into Hearthstone. And I told him about my show, and he was like, oh, dude, have you ever hit Legend before? I was like, yeah, I just hit it in September, first time ever. It was a huge rush. And he's like, oh, man, so how's your card collection? I was like, it's pretty full. and he's like, oh, that's probably why. I was like, actually, my show's about people that, you know, are in your condition where, not like cancer condition, but like, you don't have that many cards in your collection. So... I was like, well, let's just pop in. What decks do you think are cool? Like, that's my first question to people, right? You should never ask, like, what are you playing? Right? Like, what are you playing is kind of like what you ask experienced players, like, what's good? If you're asking somebody, like, what do you think's cool, and they're a new player, they're like, oh, dude, I love this druid class. It's so tight. And priest is pretty cool, but I can't seem to get it to work. And... it's like, rogue is too confusing, and you know, those type of things, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, wow, your deck is actually pretty close to what we call an aggro druid. You're like really aggressive, you have innervates, so you can use roar, and then you just like burn. He's like, yeah, that's kind of the gist. So we like moved out some deck cards. I was like, okay, so let's try to evaluate cards for you. So like, I actually walked him through a few key steps of just like, how to evaluate if a card's good or not. Like the vanilla test, you know what I mean? Like many people don't understand what the vanilla test is. And then like, telling him what an epic card is. Like an epic card is a purple icon means a card is a specific card that's used in a specific circumstance for a specific purpose. And it only does that one thing really well. So if you have a collection with a lot of epic cards, you should look through them all.
Mm-hmm.
And see how many times you're actually going to put yourself in that situation. How many times have you seen that situation arise? It's like, well, probably not that much time. I was like, okay, so second question, epic cards also do a specific thing. Is that specific thing even helpful? Most of the time, probably not. So your bestial wrath can probably hit the curb and, you know, get out of here. So we did that with Alarma Bot and bestial wrath and some other cards.
Yeah. Cool.
I really wish Bestial Wrath had charge. Could you imagine if it gave charge the Gazrilla decks you could make?
That'd be so broken.
It would be so broken.
You could run two of those and two arcane shots and just call it a day.
Emperor Tharasan, it's over.
GG.
Shall we move on to the second encounter?
Oh yeah, let's do that.
Let's keep rolling through this.
Burning too much time. Steel Sentinel. This is basically the same icon as the card you get for animated armor for mages. That's the boss fight. The boss will give you a Cursed Blade, which is a new warrior weapon for one mana. And it's a one attack, three durability, double all of the damage done to your hero. So like if you go and slam your face into a dark peddler, you take 4 damage.
So now, what's funny is, if you read it directly, double all damage done to your hero. Does that mean if you have it equipped, they throw a pyroblast at your face?
You take 20?
Yeah.
Yep.
I would assume so, because this does not look like it doesn't read Battle Cry, right? If something doesn't say Battle Cry or Death Rattle, you know that it's a persisting effect.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
See, that's...
And then my favorite card of the set is the second card, Museum Curator. 2 mana priest minion, hype, 1/2 body, battle cry, discover a random death rattle minion.
Whew.
Okay, priest master, what do you think?
Now you have to think that four times the cards are going to be class cards too, so it's going to be
priest.
Death rattle.
Four
times is likely, yes.
Yeah, that's true. I remember, didn't they have Museum Curator in like one of the games or something like that? One of the adventure bosses fights? I'm pretty sure I used that card. Mm. And I remember it gave me like neutral minions like pretty much the whole time.
Hmm.
Because like priests don't really have that many death rattle minions, right?
They just have like dark, the cultists.
That's it, right? Yeah, but it's cool. The discover mechanic is really awesome, just because you get to pick something that you wouldn't normally pick, but is great in that scenario. So that's awesome. For that reason, I think it'll probably be pretty decent. The only thing is that a 1/2 for 2 is just absolutely terrible.
Yeah, it so kind of is.
I mean, like, some part of me wants to say you see the effect and you overrate it.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, like, it fits perfectly at the same time, so...
Yeah, I think the coolest part of this card is that it actually eliminates the fact that you can't get death rattles from other classes.
That's true, yeah.
Because that's how Discover works, right?
Yeah, you can't get
You can't get a high main off this.
Right.
Hmm.
But what you can get is you can get something crappy like a leper gnome or a clockwork gnome. But you can get something awesome for priest is actually the explosive sheep. You can get a creeper. You can get a loot hoarder. You could get an Arubian egg. But you could also get like dancing swords. You can even get a shredder, harvest golem, a bomb. You can get Belchers, you can get Fugan Stalag, so maybe there'll be some Fugan Stalag Priest OTK decks again. Because imagine, like, you have a 1 in 3 chance that you're going to see this card, But actually, like, I'd be interested to see how the stats go, because it's like, it's a 1 in 3, right? So you're gonna see 3 cards, and then you have to like count how many death rattles there are, and then like add in cultists, and then multiply his multiplier by 4. You're like, math. But
you're good players. No, gonna...
I do think it's good, but I will just say, if it turns out to not end up being good, I would not be that surprised. But I do think it's good.
Shall we move on to the next encounter?
Yeah. We haven't touched on Curse Blade, but I think we're all in pretty much
Curse Blade's kind of just junk.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's another junk warrior weapon. Yeah.
They're taking a stab at maybe making this something that'll help Arena, maybe, but I think it's a rare, isn't it?
It's a rare.
I don't remember.
Isn't it a rare? Let me pull up my collection real fast.
It's a... rare, yeah.
Yeah.
It's blue. It does affect other things. Like, isn't there a legendary that gives you weapons?
Legendary that gives
it gives,
you
it gives each.
Are you talking about Captain Greenskin? That
no.
You?
It gives each player.
Linktron.
Yeah. That's what it was.
Linktron. Oh, yeah. Okay. Forgot about that guy.
That would really suck to get this off of Blinktron and your Freeze Mage.
Oh, man.
That would be brutality.
Yeah, that really sucks.
So, okay. So, yeah, let's move on to the next encounter then.
Kevin, why don't you do this one?
Okay, sure. The boss is Rafam. Rafam 1, I guess. Apparently it's 2-part. That's all I know. If you guys don't know, I never look up any of the boss fights. I always wait to be surprised, so I don't actually know anything about the encounters anyway, to spoil. But the first card you get is Curse of Rafam, which we've seen on like a couple of the adventure fights, and it's a 2-mana warlock spell that gives your opponent a cursed card that deals 2 damage to them at the beginning of their turn, if they're still holding it. And it's basically like, if you remember the Chromagus fight from Black Rock Mountain, and they used to give you those cards.
Yeah.
It's like that.
Exactly.
And you take the damage at the beginning of your turn.
Yes. That's true. So I guess this is an automatic 2 damage, right?
Pretty much.
That's cool.
Hunter hero power every turn.
It's good. It's good to play against Freeze Mage.
It can be. The problem is it's only for Warlocks, so, like,
yeah,
playing Reno, you usually don't have a problem in that matchup, right?
Right.
And then,
but this card looks dope in gold.
Yeah, right. It's cool, though. Like, it's fun.
I think a lot of these cards are fun.
That's all I care about.
Alright, yeah. What's the other card that we're going over?
Yeah.
Wobbling Runts. I'm actually quite looking forward to this. I don't think it's like that good, but I love it. It's a 6-mana 2/6, and Death Rattle summon 3/2/2 runts. What do you guys think? I want to hear your opinions.
Well, if it wasn't a runt card before it died, you'll get 3 versions of it when it does die. It'll be more runts.
Wonder if you get. It was a Nefarian that you draw cards for, or well, that's if you draw it though, huh? Not if you summon.
Oh.
Wait. Are you talking about the runts? The runts is a death rattle.
Yeah, the runts. Yeah, but it says summon 3 of them. But it's, never mind. I was thinking if you could get extra copies of them because you're getting them in your hand, but you're not getting them in your hand. It's just.
Yeah.
I misunderstood it.
Oh, okay.
I want to see someone have like Baron Rivendare with wobbling.
I was just about to say that. Yeah, it's like fill the board with 2/2s.
That sounds like so much fun.
I want to hear the animation for this card. Like, we actually haven't seen this card yet, and I'm so excited to like basically like hear the runs pop out, because Brode said each one that pops out as a new summoned minion has a separate card art.
Okay.
That's cool.
Just talking about the card itself, though, it kind of has a tragic flaw in the fact that your opponent really doesn't have to kill it.
Mm-hmm.
That being said, it would be kind of cool in a deck that buffs your creatures up. Because, like, all of a sudden, if you buff that up, then it's really scary. Oh, then you have to kill it.
Then there's silence.
Yeah.
You know what would be funny? I'm going to try it in Priest nonetheless, because it's my favorite class. But could you imagine putting that... putting Bell and Chosens on Wobbling Runts?
I mean, they become, what, a 4-12? No, a 4-10?
4-10. 4-10 Death Rattle, summon 3-2-2 Runts.
It's an easy silence target.
This to me seems like it's like a problem for token druids that they don't really have. Like a late game minion that continually fills the board.
Oh, that's a good point, actually. You can put that in that
It's kind of just too late, though. You know what I mean? Like by turn 6, you want to have the board full so you can like double roar and kill them.
Yeah, that's true.
So, I don't know.
It's like what I like to call a trump card. Which means it's super value, but it might not. It just might not fit.
Yeah. I don't think it's even worth it to silence, you know? It's kind of like one of those cards that's kind of like just subpar enough that you don't really want to silence it, but it can bait that out. So I don't know.
Yeah. Who knows? Maybe this is the card that everyone is underlooking.
Who knows? I mean, anything can happen, so.
Yeah.
Anything
we've seen things like that happen before. So
this would really suck if you could cabal it though. You're like, no, my runts.
Yep.
I do have to say, every time I hear the word runts, I think of the candy.
Replace the card art with just candy.
It's little tiny apples and bananas and and limes and stuff. All right, so
okay, so let's go into boss 4. It's Rafam Part 2 or Rafam Unleashed or something like that. So I guess he turns around and says, "Just kidding," and fights you again. He has the Eerie Statue, which is such a weird card, but I'm glad it exists. It's a 4 mana card that has a stats line that's absurd. It's a 7/7. But it says you can't attack unless it's the only minion on the field, like for both players. And then it also has the Desert Camel, which is a hunter minion. And it's 3 mana with a 2/4 body. And it says Battle Cry, put a 1-cost minion from each deck into the field. So I like both of these cards. I think it's great that like they're doing stuff like this because sometimes, you know, Zombie Child is the only thing that players are playing for a 1-drop, and other times you can get away with not playing 1-drops at all. So Desert Camel, I think, will actually see some play, but I'm just not sure how it'll fit just yet. It's great to pull Web Spinners out of your deck and improve your draw in the late game, though.
True. That is true. You know, I think that's a really solid card. It doesn't mean it has to be in every kind of Hunter deck, but It'll find its way into decks, for sure.
It's probably a good taunt minion.
And then the Eerie Statue as well.
Yeah, the Eerie Statue would be good to taunt up, and yeah.
Yeah, you know, I was thinking just what you're thinking about, putting in a handlock. Like, this or is a Shadowflame beast.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
And the problem is, it's like, what do you cut for this? Like, that list is so tight in Handlock.
It's a 2 more mana for a bigger stat. What's the 4/5 can't attack?
Ancient Watcher. For 2. See, I think that's the versatility that why you would run an Ancient Watcher over this is like AoE for 4, it only costs you 6 mana, but AoE for 7 costs you 8 mana.
That's true.
When you could just wait and take more damage and drop a Molten and then kill them. So
I wonder if anyone's going to play this and then silence, like, have an owl in their hand and silence it so they can just...
Yeah. They'll, like, be that surprise card.
Yeah.
I want to try putting it into, like, Control Warrior, where, like, your sole purpose is to have the board completely cleaned.
Yeah. Kevin, what do you think if we put, like, this in a bolster deck with the called?
Sparring partner.
Yeah.
You just throw a taunt on this thing.
That's a turn six play, right?
That is.
You got a three-two taunt and a seven-seven taunt.
Big, yeah.
Guess what we're gonna have to try tomorrow?
Yeah.
And then you can put the Anubisath Sentinels in there and get 7/7s with 1/1s.
Oh wow, that's next level, dude.
Because that would feel so bad to have to BGH something like this. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You burn that kind of removal.
That's probably smarter than putting it as a seven-seven. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. If nothing else, it's a really cool card that opens up possibilities. So, it gets rid of removal early too. Yeah.
Yeah, Kenny, what do you think of the Desert Camel? I don't think you had a chance to talk about that one yet.
I don't know about the Desert Camel. I'm not too fond of it.
Well, it doesn't fit in aggressive decks for sure, right?
So that's right there. I mean, I'm an aggressive player, so.
Well, maybe actually it could, right? Is there a one drop that has charge?
Yeah. There's the boar.
Oh, snap. Desert Camel.
Oh, snap. Forget that Kenny is the ultimate
smarter.
Ultimate cancer deck player. Yeah. gotta go fast.
A lot of people were talking about what they call an e-bullet, and I call it an aggro din recently. Uh-huh. I don't... It doesn't really fit in the meta anymore because a lot of the aggressive decks now are better than that, especially the Shaman.
It's not fast enough.
Well, yeah, the Shaman can throw out their wolves, and it. I mean, that stops. There's two taunts
out. You're toasted.
Yeah, you can't do anything.
Yeah.
So it's not as good as it was back when I was playing it. I got up to rank two, I think on it alone. So.
Okay. Well, we got class challenges. So yes. We got the Mage. You get animated armor. And then you get the Rogue Tomb Pillager card. So the animated armor is a 4-mana 4/4. Your hero only takes 1 damage at a time. And the Rogue minion is a 4-mana 5/4 with a death rattle that you get the coin in your hand when it dies.
What would you think if it was a battle cry for the animated armor, Rob?
That card would be so broken.
Yeah,
like there's no way you could balance that card. That could honestly be like 8 mana, and it would still be played.
Yeah,
it'd be like a 0/0 for like 6. And
I mean, that thing just destroys the value of Justicar Trueheart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're playing a what if?
Oh my god! I couldn't even imagine if that thing was a battle cry.
This card could be so sick, even if it was a Warlock card. Can you imagine drawing a card with this thing?
Well, not only that, but think of a Reno deck. You just get all
the only thing that I think this deck would fit in is some sort of stall mechanic for at least a turn. Like, I don't know if it's good enough to replace something in Freeze Mage yet.
Yeah, but you could put it in one of those control-y mages.
Like Echo Giants Mage?
Well, not quite like Echo Giants, but back when... even just like a standard... Like a budget... mixing ideas here. Like a budget control kind of mage. Or...
Yeah.
Even just like the old dragon control mages and all that, like I feel like it's a good card in one of those kind of decks.
Yeah, I think you could be right there.
Yeah, I mean it seems pretty good. It slows down Face Hunter. Nice. I mean, there's a lot of cancer on ladder right now, so.
Yeah, I mean. I just think that there's enough cards that can remove it. Like, you have that weird space of 4 damage and dealing 4 damage and having a 4 health body is being kind of the mix of being, you know, semi-hard removal and something that's difficult to kill as well as something that's fairly easy to kill. It's not 5 health.
Yeah. Kevin, what do you think of the Tomb Pillager rogue card?
I think it's not the worst thing I've ever seen, but it just kind of seems a little underwhelming. I mean, 4 mana for 5/4 isn't anything spectacular. And the add to your hand is okay.
The deck I would see you putting this in, you'd be like, one of those battle decks, and it's
Yeah.
The only thing I
thing is it gets a lot of value from the coin. The coin is a good activator for a lot of the combos. So that's the only one, you know.
So.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think I would play much, but. All right, so those are the cards here. I don't really, we're gonna go over some, I haven't had time to think about any. Rob, you wanna go first?
I gotta mute mine anyway. Let's see here. We missed the legendaries. So we got Archthief, Thaumbomb, and he's 9 mana. And it's a 7-8 body that Battlecry discovers a powerful artifact. Now, if I remember correctly, each of the artifacts are different. So one of them will do 10 damage, like an Avenging Wrath, where it just goes like wham, 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 wham. One at random, depending on the board. And then it'll do that up to 10 damage. And then you have a buff, which is buff a card, plus 10, plus 10. And then you have, there's another...
Was it direct damage, almost like a Pyroblast?
You know, you might be right. But that was the Avenging Wrath one. I thought it was like, maybe was it a heal for 10?
No, there was one that like filled your board with creatures. Did you miss out?
Oh, that's right. It's fill your board with 3/3 zombies. That's it.
Mm. Yeah.
That one seems crazy good. But yeah, the problem with all the artifacts is it, and Rafam, is that it uses two turns to do anything.
Yeah.
So
it's like really slow. The only thing I could see it working with is like some deck that is able to stall the game into like, into the point where both sides don't have any resources left.
Right.
And then you just draw Rafam and it's like, yeah, I have infinite value. Woo.
What do you think about this card in a Ramp Druid?
Yeah, that was like one of my thoughts. Like in a Ramp Druid, you would have to have both Innervates and a Roar. Yeah, I think it's still kind of a stretch. Because it takes three turns to pull it off.
I think it would be perfect
in like a Fatigue Warrior build. That's where I would see it.
Okay, so it just gives you an extra card and an extra couple win conditions.
Yeah, instead of having to run like Gromash for that win condition, you could just put in like Rafam and not care.
Do you have any opinions on this card? I'm not quite sure. Like, I think this is like what I would say is I'm not sure how this is gonna work. I think it could be a sleeper card like Nefarian, where it has like semi use, but it doesn't have the dragon archetype, so that's the one drawback, right?
It's kind of more of a control play. Like, I was thinking more like a warrior, a control slash fatigue warrior, because you end up having less and less minions at the end. So I mean, you could throw all a bunch of minions, or you could use it more like a like it's legendary.
I do like the versatility of the card.
Yeah.
I just feel like by the time you have the chance to play the card and then choose what you want, you still don't know what's on your opponent's board. Like when you're discovering something, you're usually discovering something to play like that turn or definitely the next turn. But like you have to plan two turns, and I don't think you can really plan two turns to play two specific cards at any one time. You have to have that flexibility where it's like, well, I guess taking a 10 damage of Avenging Wrath for 10 mana does kind of suck my turn away.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
But it is kind of cool if you were to get in that situation where it's like, oh, we just use all our cards to battle each other. But haha, I have Rafam, so I win.
Woo-hoo. Yeah, I feel like this card's closer tied as far as like evaluating it to like a Deathwing. I think it's closer to a Deathwing than any other card. Because Deathwing is like, I have nothing left. Let's just rip everything out and play it.
Yeah, that's actually a really good comparison, yeah.
So, for you budget people out there, if you're thinking about throwing Deathwing in your deck and you don't have him, you can throw an Archthief in there.
Yeah, it could be a good budget card, yeah, for sure.
All right, so what's our last legendary? Kevin, why don't you do that one? It's Elise Starseeker.
Oh, yeah, we have Elise Starseeker. I forgot about her. Oh, my God. This card
so
is
what's,
really
what's
crazy.
The body and the mana for her?
Where is it on the notes?
I don't think it is. It's a 4 mana.
Because I don't know the body of Elise.
Oh, I have my show notes open. Sorry.
Is it a four mana 3/5? It is a 4/3/5. Okay. So you get a 4/3/5, and then that gives you a map to the Golden Monkey.
For 2 mana.
So you get that card shuffled into your deck, and then when you draw that card, then you shuffle the Golden Monkey into your deck, right?
And draw
a
card.
It puts in your deck, right? Oh,
yeah, it's 2 mana, draw a card, and then shuffle the monkey in the deck. And I think it goes actually reverse order, so you have a chance of drawing the Golden Monkey after playing it.
Okay.
Like, you shuffle it in, and then you draw a card.
Okay, all right. And then, I actually didn't know that you got to draw a card on top of it, too.
Mm-hmm.
But and then the Golden Monkey is 4 cost, 6/6, and then it replaces your entire deck with legendaries.
And hand, and it's got taunt.
And oh yeah, and your hand, yeah. That's so funny.
A 4 mana 6/6 with taunt, and it's super gimmicky. And the only thing I wish about this card was that it was more like Exodia, where it just says you win the game. Like, that would be amazing.
Yeah, right? Give Hearthstone an instant win condition.
Yeah. I don't think they're ever going to do it, though. Like, 30 card decks are just not
deep enough, yeah.
Yeah, you know, like, you're not, it doesn't feel like you're able to dig long enough to have some sort of win condition like Exodia or, what was it, Final Countdown, I think that came out
yeah,
when I
Final
stopped
Countdown,
playing.
Yeah.
That was crazy.
And, it's just, there's so many mechanics nowadays, too, where you can just dig through your deck really fast.
I think the closest thing to Exodia decks is, like, Freeze Mage, you know?
Yeah. And be like, I dug through my deck in 8 turns. Exodia obliterate, you lose.
And for our deck analysis, we have Kevin Cookies.
Yeah, right? That's my kind of deck analysis.
All right.
No, yeah. I mean, you better believe I'm going to be playing it, because I'm the ultimate, I don't care about the viability, I'm just here to have fun kind of guy.
Right.
True.
I'm very curious to see what cards you can use to build this, right? Like, obviously, I think this could fit in Mage and Warrior. Those guys have, like, the most insane draw mechanics.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Whirlwind, Battle Rage.
What if you did, like, one of those new patron kind of things, and then, you just put that in there? And so when, like, you use all your stuff to get the patrons or whatever,
just,
right?
Just, like, replace a shredder with it because it's a good body.
And then, yeah, and then, like...
Dude, that's a good idea. I'm going to do that.
It's a good idea, yeah.
Let's do that.
Right? And then you kind of always get to this point where, you're like, if your patrons weren't successful, it's like, oh, I have nothing left.
Can you imagine getting, like, a full hand, like, 9 cards... And then they all change the legendaries, and one of the legendaries happens to be freaking Emperor. That would be dope. Like, Emperor, your whole hand of legendaries. That would be so sweet.
Or
that's really awesome.
Mistcaller.
What was that?
Or Mistcaller.
Oh, Mistcaller. Nerdgasm. That's so cool.
Oh, God. So many possibilities.
Okay, so the only problem I'll say with this card is not, like, the gimmick and the crazy, like, actually, like, waiting and having card draw. Because I think you can have very powerful cards that, you know, put another card in your deck and then put another card in your deck and it still be, like, strong like this. The problem is the card isn't to the point where it's strong enough for people to play. Like, competitively or even just, like, to climb with at all. Because, like, if... By the time you're drawing this card, you've got, like, less than 10 cards left in your deck, probably.
Right.
And the only value you're going to get is anything that's in your hand, and let alone, by the time you play the monkey, that's four mana, so you can only play something that's 6 mana, unless you have an Innervate in your hand, which you can't have after you play the Golden Monkey.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's a literal impossibility. You can't play Golden Monkey and do this. The best case scenario is actually not playing this in Druid, when you have it, play Aviana, Golden Monkey, and then it's got a 6/6 with taunt with Aviana on the board, and the next turn you can just dump all of your hand, and it's all legendaries.
Wow.
That would be the dream. Astral Communion,
wow.
Golden Monkey deck. Calling it right now.
Yo, what? Wow.
And then you put Naga Sea Witches in there. I mean, you put everything.
Wow.
The place! The place!
The possibilities!
This is such a broed card.
But what would, such a broed card. I don't think that Naga Sea Witch is going to do anything, though. I mean, if you have Aviana, that's all you need. Why have Naga Sea Witches?
Because you can play Aviana sooner.
Yeah.
So, like, they don't override each other.
Oh, gotcha.
Or the Naga Sea Witches don't override Aviana just for spells. So you can just have a druid deck that has, like, all card draw, or, like, a mill druid deck, and then you have, like, a couple of these cards in there. And, like, you literally could run anything in your freaking deck that you want, because your whole goal is just changing the cards to something else.
So you have to draw the witch before the legendary, so...
Yeah, and most of the time, they're either going to ignore the minion or just put up a wall so it can't hit you for 5, because it is a 5-5 for 5. It passes a vanilla test, so it does work. But next turn, you can play, like, Aviana and another minion on turn 6. That's pretty crazy.
That's awesome.
All right, so, well, we're kind of running late in the show. We're going to skip a couple of the things we're going to talk about, like our predictions, maybe even the snapshot. We'll skip that, too. Let's go over some of the... so we didn't actually get any emails this week. Surprise, surprise. So please send in your emails to coinconcede@gmail.com so we have an email to read, something to talk about. We might not be able to get it to it next week, so I'll give you an extra week before we start talking about it because we have the joint podcast. But I don't know how that'll work quite yet, but we'll be on that. So this section, we're actually going to... go over some free-to-play questions kind of came up with. I've been coming up with a couple during the show. And then, yeah, if you want to pipe in too, Kevin, anything too. So let's first, a couple questions for Rob here. What would you suggest, or would you suggest dusting golden cards for free-to-play players to get cards that they need?
Okay, so I think we say this almost every episode now, except for the ones we talked about League of Explorers, just because adventures are different. But I think players, instead of like asking all of the questions, need to realize that there's one question they need to ask themselves before they ask any question. And that is, what are your goals? Like, what is the goal of sitting down and playing this game? Is my goal to have fun? Is my goal to win? Because sometimes, if you have both of those goals simultaneously, your deck and your style of play is going to be different than somebody who is like a Legend of the Innkeeper type player where they just literally want to have fun. They don't care if they're ranked 25 or Legend. They're just like, I'm here to goof around. I want to play freaking Golden Monkey every day, all day. Hate is going to hate type player. And then you have other players that are like, I'm going to freaking Ebola Den to Legend because I hate my own life and I just want to win. No, that was just a slam against Kenny. But yeah, I mean, you have players that just like love smorking decks. Like that's what Firebat got the world championship because of how the game was played the first year. So going back to your question, dusting cards depends on what your goal is going to be. Like, is your goal eventually to have a good card collection that also happens to have some golden cards in it? Then maybe you slowly pace yourself and keep the golden cards that you like. And then dust the ones you don't think you'll ever play or the ones you just don't like at all.
That's a very good point, just because mine, like taking a look at myself, I kind of switched my goals after meeting a certain point. So like I ended up getting all the cards that I need. I don't really need to go for cards anymore. So then I was like, okay, I got my first golden hero. I'm going to start creating some golden cards.
Gold cards, yeah.
Oh my gosh, did I find out how expensive they were to make?
Yeah, when you finally make that goal decision, it's massive undertaking.
So that changed my goal immediate to never dust any golden cards. Never.
Yeah.
I know when we first started the show, Kevin and Cora were on my case over dusting some golden legendaries.
I am the type, well, obviously I'm just a have fun player, so I always yell at people for disenchanting gold cards because I'm like, dude, you have no idea how rare that is and expensive.
Yeah, like opening the Skeleton Knight or the Beast in golden, I actually have done that and I don't want to dust them because it's like...
Because you're never going to get it again.
What's the statistical chance that I'm ever going to do that ever again? Period.
Yeah.
It's literally less than... it's less than half a percent. It's less than half a percent that you're going to open that card.
Yeah.
Or actually, I think it's exactly 0.5% that you're going to open that card.
Yeah. All right.
So it's crazy.
Let's go through some of these other questions. We have a couple more, and then we got to end up wrap up the show. But are there any certain adventures you would actually suggest budget or free to play players to get first? And what order would you put them in?
I will actually say that the quickest way to do this is to evaluate what's in every wing and what cards you want. Especially if you're only spending gold. Like, if you're considering spending some money, it's fine. Like, buy this whole adventure, get this wing with gold, and you're good to go. So I would say try to get as many of the next cards as you can. If you can't afford the whole adventure, I would say, like, okay, just look at the wings of the cards you want. And then get the first wing of Blackrock Mountain. I think those are your first two cutoffs. Like, you need the Emperor, you need the Patron, you need those class cards, and then figure out which wings later in Blackrock that you're going to need additional cards. Like, if you're going to play Druid and you want to, like, do your Beast thing, maybe you need the Druid of the Flame, so get that one.
I think generally the first one has a lot of good Death Rattle neutrals that fit in a lot of different decks. So I would say that's a good point to keep in mind with there. And then also, how do you weight Discover as a mechanic too? Just because free-to-play, you get the choice of playing cards you may not have.
Right. So again, it goes back to goal setting and how you play the game. I would say, like, if you're looking for more exciting, fun cards to play, you could... I would honestly say, like, buy Naxxramas with money, save 1,400 gold, and then buy the first wing of Blackrock and the first wing of Legend of the League of Explorers, because then you get Reno and, you know, whatever.
Emperor.
You get Emperor, yeah.
Yeah. I used to teach a lot of my friends to play Hearthstone and coach a lot of new players, and the thing I always said was, I always told them that Hearthstone was effectively a $15 game. Because you should really buy Naxxramas.
Yeah.
Like, that's what I always would tell people.
I think it's getting close to being a $40 game, if that makes sense.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's different nowadays, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because all the other
stuff. Something we're going to be talking about on our show, like, this week, next week, and the Christmas week. We're actually going to be addressing this. Like, how do we transition now?
Mm-hmm.
Like, we got all the hype cards. We're going to be done this week. And then next week, meta starts sitting in and starts... shifting to where it's going to be permanently until the next set releases. But, you know, that's kind of what everyone's thinking. But, like, what is the majority of players thinking? Like, what are we going to do with our budgets? Like, am I going to get screwed? Are they going to just keep giving me new discounts periodically? Or are they just going to give me a flat rate eventually? Because it's going to be a pretty expensive game.
Yeah.
All right. And... Kevin, you want to interject with any questions before I move on to my last two?
Go ahead.
Okay, I'll keep going. So I've heard people actually talk about dusting certain classes cards, like Rogue. Like, they figure that, this is gonna be hard class. Oh, I'll ever play.
I interject real quick?
Sure.
Oh my god, when I was a somewhat new Hearthstone player, I did that once. With my Rogue cards, I said I'm never gonna play this class because Rogue is, like, my least mm-hmm. favorite class. And I, even though Rogue is my least favorite class, I did that and I regretted it so badly. Like, really? I dusted my preparations and my Edwin Van Cleef, and then, like, because I mean, if you plan on playing the game for a while, you're gonna want to play that class at some point.
Yeah,
right? Like. And then so all of a sudden, you know, I was like, I got the bug to play Rogue. I was like, oh, I want to play some Rogue. And then I had to craft all the cards again because I destroyed all my Rogue cards. Yeah, I used to be a chronic disenchanter, and I would, like, dust cards and then recraft them later.
Yeah, so I just Kenny, stopped you got busting. Out your question, though, didn't you?
That's pretty much he addressed it, too. I mean, would you suggest someone who's starting out to
do that?
I
think you got players that are like, do you... Like, Eve actually just did this. She, like, disenchanted a ton of cards because she's like, I want to play Dragon Priest, and I want a Stinking Vulgin, and I want two Light Bombs, and not one, and I want a Chillmaw, and I want, you know, like, I want to play Priest, and I want to play it well, and so I'm going to make sure I have everything in my arsenal to do that. And I think that's a very good strategic way to go about playing the game initially. I don't think that's something you should continually do long term. I think that's something you want to, like, sit down with your collection and really think long and hard, like Kevin was saying. Like, I'm never going to play this is usually something that you'll regret saying. Like,
yeah.
I mean, realistically, I would say for the average player that has the average amount of money, you need to look at your cards and say, if this is a class I'm not willing to play initially, I need to look through all of the rares and all of the commons, and I'm going to look through all of those and actually look at decks and see, at least currently, if I change my mind, I won't regret it. I'm going to find all of the core cards that are being played, and I'm going to keep them, and then I'm going to dust everything else. And you can even consider that on the bubble decision of like, well, I have one of these. Is it okay if I dust the second one? This is a one-of card. Then, yeah, let's dust this. Mm-hmm. But you have to remember the statistical chance of drawing rares is just like any other card game in the market. Getting rares, you're guaranteed one. You're guaranteed four. You're guaranteed the rest of the cards will at least be common, if not better. But you're not guaranteed to pull a lot of epic cards. Like, when I first opened my TGT packs, like the first 50, I had a pretty good haul. Like, I hauled buns. I got four legendaries. Problem nice. Was, I didn't pull, like, any epics. Like, any. I got, like, maybe five. And they were all crap. So it's like, do I dust these? Yeah, absolutely I dust these.
I got, but like, I have six to go poison craft, blades.
Like, yeah, exactly. It's like, poison blades. This card is never going to see play ever. Like, in what world is this card good? Never. Never will it ever be played. Well, you know, like, you'd never say that with any cards in Hearthstone. For the record, but if you need dust, I mean, you got to look long and hard at those useless epics and think about those. But more than that, you're not gonna regret the rares and the commons as much, you know, because those are more frequently seen. You're gonna open more packs. It'll happen, and the statistics are in your favor. The odds are in your favor, as they would say. So
I don't know why you dust commons though.
It's a Hunger Games. Because
you only get five dust. What's the point?
Well, I mean, if you're trying to fill out your collection, you're maybe not necessarily like what Kenny was saying, you're trying to fill out a one class thing. So you maybe you're missing a couple commons, and it's okay to craft those. Or you're missing like five dust to make a knife juggler.
Mm. Yeah, I suppose. True.
So if it pushes you over the bubble and you have a lot of crappy commons, then you might as well. I mean, that's
yeah, right. Fair enough.
It's enough to get you 100 dust. Because that's what I did in my collection on EU. It's like, what are the cards that you're looking to craft first? It's like, well, given my given collection and all the packs that I've opened, I can play Warlock and I can play Paladin. And people are like, how'd you play Paladin? Well, you play the freaking aggressive one that's just nuts. And, you know, Blessings of Might, Kings, all that stuff. So I was like, well, I'll just dust a bunch of cards. I made two Muster for Battles. I made one Mini Bot because I was missing one. And then I made two Knife Jugglers and two Defenders of Argus. And that's all. And then, like, I had enough left for one Azure Drake. It's like, that's... They're all classic cards, you might say. Well, yeah, it's because classic cards are the best cards.
Yeah, right.
Like, the most versatility of anything. The only exception would be Shredders. And I happen to pull two of those. I got really lucky, so...
Oh, nice.
And Muster.
Well, I crafted those.
Yeah. All right, so... Kevin, you have any other free-to-play or budget questions for him before... We move on?
No.
All right. So I'm just going to tease a little bit here. I was going to write in an email. I'll just do it as a voice mail, I guess, for your show, and I'll send it in for you. So basically, when you get to the point of accumulating all the cards that you want, what are the top five legend? I was going to have each of you actually explain what your top five legendaries, like what you would say you would craft first, then second, then third.
We should narrow this down to top three.
But well,
yeah, let's do three. I always used to love answering this question.
Okay, and then
but the reason why I say five though is because maybe some people do have those already, or maybe they already crafted.
That's true. Okay.
So
it's clearly Flame Leviathan, Malorn, and Aether Kapir. Right,
so we won't talk about it on this show, but I'll just tease it by saying go listen to Velen's Chosen and see what their answers are.
We'll address that for sure.
And then also, Rob's been actually been doing. I said we weren't going to talk about it. Yeah, so Rob actually has been doing a couple of write-ups on some of the decks he's been using to play some of these adventures, at least the wings that are
the heroic bosses,
the heroics, and trying to get keyword trying to get as basic and common as possible for free to play players and even budgets. He's trying to get as close as he could, but you know, you got to make some exceptions here and there. So go check out some of his decks that he's been posting. Do you want to pimp that out?
Yeah, I mean, basically, I just linked you to my Hearthpwn deck guides that I've written. Some of them are super ancient, like a Gothic the Harvester mill deck that was for normal. That was back when I was completely free to play. But then I have like some stuff even from, you know, Blackrock Mountain on there. But like the current set is the one that I'm really pushing, like Kenny was saying. I will say this. The first two wings are incredibly attainable by any player. Like, there, I saw that people had posted on Reddit, especially for Wing 2. I think Wing 2 is easier than Wing 1. Yeah. But, like, for Wing 2, they made a deck guide for the normal bosses that you could do the normal bosses with only basic cards, like vanilla-type cards.
Yeah.
I was like, dang, that's impressive. Like, they're making this super attainable for us. And then you walk into Heroic, and it's like, you know, this, they are definitely doing what they can to make this more attainable on some level, I think, for getting people in. Because I think that was one of the things that I hated about Nax and BlackRock, is it's like every especially single BlackRock boss sucks in Heroic. It's like so hard.
I think that's what it turned Kevin off of Nax Ramis, was doing the BlackRock.
Really?
You did the BlackRock, right?
It's more just like I'm too lazy to do it, to be honest.
They take a lot of time, like 20 yeah. efforts on each boss almost. I was like grinding them out. It was so bad.
Yeah. But
and the payoff is just a card back.
Pretty much the only reason I did it for BlackRock is because I was bored.
Mm.
It's actually interesting though, because I'm actually making your Temple Escape deck right now. I feel like doing some of these. So I think I'm going to do this after the show.
Yeah, yeah. I will say the most recent wing was really hard for me and Kenny alike on Heroic. And these decks aren't like the greatest. So I will say, please read all of the substitutions and try to like change them to fit your, not only your collection, but fit the playstyle of the deck.
Well, I think
one of them is like a Healing Priest and it doesn't really fit. And I kind of just got the God Draw in one. So you might actually have to shift some cards around and also, you can get it to work better.
Also, when you check out his lists, he actually has like what would be optimal, and then he has substitutions which would substitute him to more basic cards. So he doesn't he goes the opposite way, where instead if you have these cards, you can sub them in. It's the other way around. So just keep like check out the substitutions. He's been getting a lot of flack
different,
on
it's different for every boss too. Like the most recent one is more like I think this is the best deck, but I could be wrong because like those bosses sucked and people were winning with like Face Hunter and stuff. So
were you getting flack on Reddit for people are saying this isn't a free to play deck? Read the whole thing.
I got so much flack on Reddit. People are stupid.
What are you gonna say, Kevin?
Is this still the case where like a lot of the bosses can be beat by, like, OTK priests and stuff?
Yeah, it's funny, because I was like, alright, I'm going to make guides, and none of them will be OTK priests. But, I mean, you never know. You never know. OTK priests is, traditionally, like, there's two ways to beat all of the heroic bosses. An OTK priest deck with Lightwells, or a deck that runs a crap ton of taunts and Kel'Thuzad, because the bosses will always bug out. Always.
That's the other thing too. You could find beating a lot of the bosses are with the Freeze Mage. You know, it's
Freeze Mage is another failsafe for most of the bosses.
Oh yeah, yeah.
It doesn't work very well in some of the heroics, like especially like the Nefarian one. That sucks because like all this armor, you break the armor, then Onyxia comes in, and Alexstrasza doesn't work, and it's like there's so many of these things that just don't work. And then Freeze Mage doesn't really work for the my demographic for our show. Because people are like,
it's kind of
there's
expensive.
There's so many rare cards and epics and legendaries. I don't even have Thalnos. That card's garbage.
Like,
rip Thalnos.
All right.
No more souls.
So I think that pretty much sums up kind of the free-to-play section we created here. Let's go ahead and go through some of our thank yous. We actually got a Stitcher review.
Hype?
It's kind of long, so I'll switch.
Yay!
Yay! Oh,
there you go.
It didn't click at first. That was weird. You love that, don't you?
Oh man, that's my favorite part about Coin Concede.
Yeah, I like it too. That and the buffers.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, the music is awesome.
Like the foundations of the world, baby.
Yeah. All right, so it was a little too long to read as far as the review on the Stitcher, but thanks for your review. We do appreciate it. I know there's been some issues with some of the Stitcher podcasts and being able to.
Yeah.
I don't know what the issue is.
Yeah, Angry Chicken's been having some issues.
But I'm glad you listen, and thanks for being there for us. Thanks for those that did show up for at least part of the podcast live on our stream. And yeah, let's go ahead and thank some of our we have a Stefan who actually we borrowed the cover from. You can check out his YouTube channel on our show notes, so we use that for the intro and the outro music. And thanks to Zoe Zazu for creating our logo. You can follow her at Zoe Zazu on Twitter. And about us, you can catch our blog posts at coinconcede.com along with our show notes. Follow us on Twitter at coinconcede. And like and share our Facebook page at facebook.com/coinconcede. I usually have a shout out, but I guess my shout out this week is going to be to Rob. Coming through.
Oh, man, you stole mine.
Oh, okay, then I'll leave that one for
Kevin,
you.
You're not allowed to love me anymore.
That's the only one I have, so. So, yeah.
Yeah, I gave Kevin a really dope priest deck in the pre-show, so.
Yeah, so I think I have the rights to that one.
It's all good.
All right. Yeah. Well, then I'll just give an update. Cora has not been playing Hearthstone for like a week, 2 weeks.
Days.
No, she hasn't played at all. She's been on her trip, and she's in like, I thought I saw a picture of her in Greece. I think that's where she went. But,
yeah.
Hopefully she has a lot to talk about when she gets back. Or maybe she'll have nothing to talk about because she hasn't been playing.
Yeah.
One or the other.
All right. And Rob, you want to give any shout-outs to anybody before we go give our contact information?
Shout-out to Kibler for being the most legit like deck builder of all the decks that I like playing. I just can't stand it. Like Kibler's he really just cool. Always brings the decks that I want to play and like makes them before I can think about it. So very cool.
Yeah.
And then shout out to my co-host Andrew and Eve, best dang co-hosts in the business. So
I don't know, but mine are pretty good too, though.
Yeah. Well, I'm a little biased.
All right.
As are we.
Yeah. 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 Exactly.
Yeah.
All right. So since Cora's not here, you can just to let you know where you can find her. You can. Find her at VS_CG Songbird on Twitter and SageCore on Twitch. Kevin, where can we find you?
I was going to say you can find her in Greece. There you go.
Good luck.
You can follow me on Twitter at KevinCookies, with cookies is spelled with a K, as I'm sure you all know by now. Feel free to tweet me something. I check Twitter fairly regularly now. You guys kind of got that on me. So, yeah. And on Twitch, it's twitch.tv/Kevin_cookies. If you see me in any channel, feel free to say hi. Yeah.
All right. And so. Rob, where can we find you at? What are you up to?
Okay. So I'm on a lot of places. We'll put them in the show notes. You can find me on Twitter mainly is my main thing. That's just @notrob. Pretty easy to find me. I'm on Steam if you want to play Rocket League. I'll put that in the show notes. And I do actually another podcast. It's a comedy podcast that me and some dorks that I taught in China. We taught English together, and it's really fun. We do some ridiculous stuff on that podcast. It's really casual, super hilarious. And then you can check out my show, Velen's Chosen Podcast. If you want to find us on Twitter, it's just Velen's Podcast. Send us some cool stuff, what cards you're opening. Send us some emails, any questions you may have.
Cool.
We just got our first Patreon supporter yesterday. Okay. So
I was gonna be your first. I haven't gotten around to it. I'm still gonna do it, don't worry about it.
Yeah, so shout out to Gabriel. I guess that's my other shout out. Gabriel's the man. First guy to give us $5 a month. That guy's awesome.
Thank you. That's a good segue into our actual Patreon, too.
Yeah.
We have ours is a Coin Concede podcast. So there definitely check it out. We're going to add, after the holidays, actually, we're all going to get together and put a video together. We're going to be doing a lot more on there. I've been posting all the shows. But we'll start getting a little bit more involved after the holidays when Cora gets back. So
yeah.
Look forward to some of those.
Anything? Patreon hype.
Yeah, anything you want to mention about Valens Chosen too? Or...
Yeah, we're on Twitter, Facebook. You can email us. Everything's like super simple. It's either Valens Podcast or Valens Chosen Podcast. You can find it anywhere. Our website is where you can find the most stuff, and it's basically just like extended show notes and links and deck guides and blah, 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 blah. All that's on Post Haven is like our handle. So you just go to valenschosen.posthaven.com and find anything you want.
Cool. All right.
Even and love.
Rob love. All right. And for me, you can follow me at KCCO_gamer on Twitter and Twitch. Same thing. KCCO_gamer. I think that basically wraps up our show. You listen to the show, so you know how to end it. So last thing I'm going to say is keep calm and chive on. And until then, coin concede.
Coin concede.
Coin concede.
You have bested.
Done.
You win this
time. I concede.
You win this time.
Well fought. I concede. You win this one, friend.
The victory is yours.
I give up.